You, are we live? I don't know until we go live. I mean, until you comment in the chat. Shout out to everybody. We have a giveaway, FL Studio giveaway tomorrow. Me and Bricks are doing a dual giveaway. That's at Bricks Domain, D-A-M-A-N-E, and B-R-I, Bricks, the way you spell the regular word Bricks. But I'm here for this live stream to just talk a little bit because we've had a lot of disgruntled folks in the producer community. And we need to definitely address these issues because, you know, we don't need any more division. I think we need more cohesion than division. Because a lot of us are taking off and it's time we build our own society versus trying to kill each other off. JW Turbo, what's up? Triz Da Vinci, we live. So I'm sure you guys saw the YouTube with Dylan from Producer Grind. And, you know, I have my comments about it. But what I'll do is I'll keep a neutral stance. So if Wylo's watching, I'm keeping a neutral stance. If Cash Money AP's watching, I'm keeping a neutral stance. What I'll speak to is the business acumen of it all. And I'll speak to the general concept as to the things that I see. So it's not a who's right, who's wrong. I don't play that game. I could have titled this video, Wylo versus Cash Money AP to get clicks and all that type of stuff. I could have been the controversial guy, but I don't stand for that. I don't think producer division is going to help anything. So let me really quick go open up the chat, say what's up to my folks. Who else we got in here? We got JW. We got Triz Da Vinci up in here. Nino on the beat. What's good? Nexus Beats. Armand. Armand, what's up, Armand? Daniel's here, Jimenez. I'm going to be quick with the intros because I want to get straight to it. Almighty Rodney's here, DeAndre is here, Rashawn's here, what's up? Lil Yurti. Rehan's here, what's up? Bufo from Sparta, New Jersey, hailing at 162 pounds. Happy Thursday. Yeah, this is a good Thursday. We're going to be live streaming today. I feel better, finally. Ice Mike, what's up? Cold Cut. 8-Bit is here. What's up for joining in? Honor Rebel. What's good? I'm doing the Ab McCree. What's good? HR313. Black Lifer. All right, we're about to get to it. Give me a second to say what's up to folks real quick, and then we'll get straight to the content. Pat, what's it say? Pattison Fat? Not sure if I'm saying that right. Wait, where's the other screen? Hold on. My screen just disappeared. Let's make it look like this. So again, I'm not one for controversy really within the music producer community. I think people, when they have truths to speak, I feel like they should have a platform to speak their truth. I just don't like pitting producers against other producers. I think that's garbage. I really do think that's garbage. And that happens a lot. Okay. So Halgas, what's up? King Lemuel. What's up? All right, so let's get to it. Shout out to everybody else. Forgive me for... If you have questions, you can at BusyWorks Beats and then hit your question that's related to this live stream. Please don't ask me about how to slide 808s in this live stream. This is not the live stream. Oh, you guys skipped. What's up, Christian? Christian Rast. All right, my bad if I skipped you guys. I just want to get to the point. So thanks for joining, firstly. Again, I could have titled this Wylo versus Cash Money AP, but I didn't for a reason because I just feel like that fuels the... negative conversation. Dylan, I love Dylan. This title though, Wylo talks stolen sample on Pop Smoke album. So it's kind of insinuating that it was stolen, which is kind of putting an angle to it. So I wanted to introduce this without an angle. And again, Dylan and I are on good terms. I'm not here to bash Dylan. I'm just saying this title kind of alludes to Wylo's side. So people who are viewing that are going to have a Wylo perspective versus a neutral perspective. But what I will speak to are the truths that I've seen in the industry, regardless of the name and regardless of who's behind it. So firstly, I want to shout out everybody in the chat because you guys are actually taking the time to educate yourself and be uplifted. One major distinction here is that you have, and there was a guy who joined into Dylan's stream talking about how producers shouldn't sign to other producers. And I forget his name, but shout out to him. We got a Karen in the chat. There we go. Mainly comes down to this. You have producers who are entrepreneurs, and then you have producers who aren't entrepreneurs. And that sounds basic, but what it comes down to is certain people don't want the stress of starting a business testing an idea for years, sometimes without a profit, and then hiring employees and having to provide for their lifestyles along with their own. So some people just don't want the stress. Not that they're not capable, they just don't want that stress. So those are the people who just want to work alongside people and support people versus being the one behind the CEO role. Because, for example, you know, let's come up with what's a cool company, you guys? Give me like a really dope company that you love specifically. It doesn't have to be music related. I'm just trying to make a point. But I want you guys to tell me your favorite, well, one of the favorite companies that you have. And this is going to be interesting, actually. I'm curious what you guys have to say. Shout out to everybody up in here. All 92 of y'all. All 93 of y'all. No, shout out to you guys. But I had to do my live stream because I was listening to Dylan's live stream and then he had a caller come in and I could tell the conversation was being slanted after a certain point, and it wasn't neutral after that point. That's why I just was like, let me come live so that we can clear up this mess in the producer community. Microsoft. Interesting. Yeah, they made Xbox, so you can't hate on Microsoft. Goodness. GTA 5 alone lasted like 15 years with the same price. I couldn't get it on discount. Qbeats, you like it? His company? Isotope. Okay, they're dope. I went to their headquarters up in Cambridge. Activist, not sure what that is. Sony, okay. PlayStation, can't go wrong. Body Armor, is that a company? Oh, Body Armor is the company, duh. What's the best way to learn keyboard? This is not a music talk right now. Nike, Qbeats, Akai, EA Sports. Okay, Akai. They made the NPC. Again, you can't go wrong when you make anything that we love and use. But for example, Sony. We can love the company Sony, and I could love Microsoft because they made Xbox and some of the greatest games in history. But that doesn't mean I want to run the Microsoft company. That's a stress I would never want on my life. The time restrictions, the life restrictions, the mental, it's like being president. You would just instantly grow gray hairs. So I love Microsoft, but I would not want to be the CEO. I don't care how much money he's making. It's not worth the stress. So in that case, we can love a role like a producer, but that doesn't mean we want to be an entrepreneur producer. And I think that's the misconception a lot of us have, because producers back in the day, they used to be all entrepreneurs. Most of them weren't really like an employee to somebody else unless they were signed and almost used as like an instrument to create stuff. But think about it this way. What's up, Big A? You're a producer, and when you want someone to interpolate, or if you want someone to like create loops for you, you hire somebody else to do it. But you're the producer who puts it all together. What's up, Sleepy? So my point is, oh, I thought that said DM. I was like, I have so many DMs, I don't really check them anymore. Oh, okay. Shout out to you. But my point in saying this is that every producer is not an entrepreneur. The same way every producer can hire a musician, but sometimes the labels hire producers to be, in a sense, a musician for them. And my point in saying all this is to say that signing to a producer is not a negative thing, especially when you can get actual benefits. So let's get into, we're getting to that a little bit. That's the third point I want to make, is signing to another producer. What are the benefits? Now, they're all going to differ based on the producer, but I want to give you real tangible benefits you get outside of just somebody trying to latch to your name for a come up, as the one guy said in the call in with Dylan, because I felt like that was one side of it. I can see that being the case because I've signed to what's called an MCN on YouTube, for example. Shout out to everybody in here. I've signed to an MCN on YouTube, for example. All they did was offer me tools that cost about $15 a month, and I was giving them 30% of my YouTube revenue. So in a sense, they tricked me saying that I would get all these benefits. And here's one thing you guys really have to understand. When you're talking to anybody before you sign anything, I learned this from a law firm. First law firm I worked with, RRHC, they said words in the air are not there. That means if somebody's trying to woo you on the phone, take you out to cool dinners, fly you out to whatever state and come to their studio, and they're just talking about all the stuff they're going to do for you, unless you have it on paper, it is not real. I don't care how much you like the person. I don't care how much you trust the person. Unless, you know, this only exception is Street Code and Jay Prince. Like, but the reason Jay Prince can get away with not having contracts with people and not doing paperwork is because there's enforcement in the streets, whereas there is no enforcement for you being flown out to somebody's studio talking about they're going to sign you and link you up with this person, then that person. There's no enforcement. You don't have some kind of street team to go knock on that person's door. And I'm using symbols because I'm not trying to make this a violent message. What I'm saying is there are real benefits to signing to a producer, but unless it's written down, that is a number one rule. Words in the air are not there, period. I don't care how cool they make it sound. I was lied to basically when I got signed up with my MCN on YouTube. They said, hey, we're going to get you in with Chief Keef and all these popping people at the time. And I signed up to their thing. You know, I read through the contract. It sounded fair at the time because I thought I was going to get all these benefits that the guy was talking about. Then I found out it was not what it really was. And I found out I can get the same tools for $15 a month. Meanwhile, they're taking 30% of $5,000 a month. What is that? 30% of $5,000 a month. Let's do some math. So 5,000 times 30, that's 15. That's basically $2,000 a month they're taking for something I could have got for 15 bucks. And they're offering no life-changing anything. So that's basically like a YouTube label. And I was in that for 4 years. They were eating off of me. Now that's something that you want to avoid, is words in the air are not there. Avoid that because it can actually cost you. So let me do an average cost. So I was on there for 4 years. They were taking about $2,000 a month for 4 years. So something I say, so 2,000 times 12 times 4, that's $100,000 that I gave away because words in the air are not there. Meanwhile, I could have spent, let's see, times 4, I could have spent $720 and saved myself $100,000. $720 compared to $100,000 lost to somebody else who basically lied because words in the air are not there. That's just why I'm trying to really stimulate your mind and give you a different perspective. We'll get into all the side talk about music and 808 slides in a little bit. We're not talking about that right now. Okay, so really be careful with that. Words in the air are not there. So that's the first rule you have to learn. I learned that from a law firm. Okay. Now, moving forward, there are benefits to signing to real producers. Okay. But make sure those benefits are written. Okay, now I made that point. Let's move to the next point. So this stream, again, if you just joined, the stream is about producer credits. It's about robbing loops, how producers are doing that and why they do it and how they do it and the mentality behind it. I'll get into that. And it's about signing producers. Okay, so we tapped into signing producers a little bit. I'll come back to that because there are real benefits to that sometimes. And then we'll tie into our other points. So again, this podcast is going to be straightforward. I'm not going to be sugarcoating, telling random stories going about. It's going to be straight information because you guys need to understand this if you want to move forward. And again, my goal is not to tear down the producer community. However, I love Dylan from Producer Grind. He is a really great guy. This title, however, kind of insinuates that something bad has happened. It says Wylo talks stolen sample on Pop Smoke album. So for that reason, it's kind of like indirectly accusing Cash Money AP of something. So that's why I want to keep this extremely neutral and just talk about the business stuff at hand without any angle. I'm only telling you my personal stories and that's it. Now, Dylan, again, I respect Dylan and Producer Grind. They actually have the best merch probably in the world for producers in the world. I don't know if you guys can see it, but I'm wearing his shirt. Hold on, let me make my screen a little bit bigger. But yeah, I bought like everything that he had released. And hold up. How do you make this thing bigger? Oh, here we go. Let's just make it bigger. What am I doing? But this, I have like every shirt. So shout out to Dylan because his merch is crazy. So shout out to, I don't know if they have any more merch left, but if they do, you should probably get it. Definitely awesome stuff. Their shorts are amazing. Shout out to Dylan. Okay, so again, this is not a criticism against Dylan. I'm just saying that with so much sensitivity going around, I don't want to offer an angle because that can shift the tides into more division if we're not careful. That's what I'm saying. Okay. So Dylan said that he wanted Cash Money AP to potentially come on the show. And if I'm Cash Money AP and I see the title Wylo Talks Stolen Sample on Pop Smoke album, I'm already walking into a courtroom against me. So it's not really a fair, neutral conversation. So if anybody knows Cash Money AP, he wants to hop on Zoom. I'll reach out in my DM because, again, we have to have not only the story from both sides, we need to understand how to keep peace within our own community. Because again, this could create, let's put it in street terms, right? This could create a civil war within the producer community. It could create a street war of unnecessary ramifications, because now if we don't settle this, what happens is it spawns the conversation about online versus industry producers, because Wylo has products online and he deals with industry people. Then it spawns the conversation of what's called vendors or suppliers to the merchants, which means it spawns the conversation of sound designers to producer relationships. So now we have, so for example, a lot of big producers you guys might not know, shout out to everybody in here. I respect everybody in here to take the time to get another perspective. But a lot of producers you guys don't realize, they use their main goal. Let me preface this because I forgot to mention something. I've been in a room, a studio session, multiple sessions with people with 10 billion plus streams combined. 10 billion. It was five people in the room. Combined, they had over 10 billion streams. They've worked with the top acts, Post Malone, YG, French Montana, Drake, Young Thug. Who else is dope? Ray Shremmer. What's his name? Smoke Perp. Anybody, all the top people in the industry. This is basically hip hop's greatest producers in one room. And when I was in that room, you know, I'm not going to give the details, but basically what it comes down to is this. They have certified people that they go to for their loops because they know that that person is going to do good business with them. They know that person probably didn't steal the loops from somebody else trying to repackage it. They know how to contact the person. They know the person will clear the loops. So there's a system. They have a defined what's called supplier chain or supply chain. So they don't necessarily sit in the studio sessions and make beats from scratch all the time. They take loops because, again, when you're in the studio on paid time, it's a different ballgame. That's something that you guys might not understand from home because you've never been in a session with producers out in LA or Atlanta when they have to go to the studio to make beats. You can't just make beats in your house and ship them off. You know, they're collabing in the studio. It's a whole different thing. So you're paying $50 an hour. Let's say they get a discount and they're paying $20 an hour even. They don't want to waste that time trying to make a melody. They're saying, okay, here's a pool of melodies. If I feel uninspired or whatever, I'm on paid time. You know, this is costing me $20 an hour. Here's a set of loops that I know are going to work, that I know are from good sources, and that I know are going to be clearable. They use those loops, they give the credits, and they have the whole history with that person. They put them in their beats, and they only do business with a couple people. So imagine if I was McDonald's, the corporation called McDonald's, okay, and I wanted to make French fries. I wouldn't just go to any farm in America and just do deals with any potato grower in America. I would have qualified potato growers, ones that can grow the potatoes fast, ones that can grow them ethically, one that can grow them, you know, with all the proper things without any pesticides or whatever the rules are. And then I would have a definitive supply chain based on curation and based on quality and the quantity that they can push out. So the same thing with these top producers, they have supply chains. And I don't want the producer community to create division within supply chains, because what this does is, unintentionally, of course, is that this creates division in the supply chain, which could mirror what's happening in the real world. So for example, right now, a lot of you guys may wonder why you can't get toilet paper or paper towels or Lysol. Like, when's the last time you guys have seen a Lysol or a Clorox sanitary wipes? Like, when is the last? I want to know. I haven't seen any that you can buy in the last 2 to 3 months. I have not seen any Lysol for sale, no Clorox for sale, no Clorox wipes. Like, have you guys seen them? I want to know, because if you have, we need to go to your state and buy some. I haven't seen any, so we had to preserve ours. And my point in saying that is the same thing goes with these supply chains of loops. Once the people, the trusted sources of loop makers, start having a disinterest or a dissonance with the producer community who is actually using their supply chain, it creates lack of connection and lack of transaction, which means this, now the suppliers are going to hold on to their supplies and potentially distribute them a different way, which means they're not going to give them to the producers to then flip into their placements. They're probably just going to hold them and put them out as packs or do their own beats. And they're going to basically kill the flow of the symbiotic relationship. What does this mean? This means that you're creating a recession within a community. Regardless of the recession out here, you're creating less transaction within the community itself. So give me a second. My mic's tripping out. Hold up. There we go. My bad. I should have switched that earlier. Okay. Should be able to hear me a little bit more clearly. So again, this is what I don't want to spawn in the producer community, is that if we keep hearing stories like this story, and if sound designers constantly feel like they're being ripped off, now that severs all future relationships with people who are actually going to do good business with them. And it creates an internal civil war, whether it's said or not. Losing that trust can happen on a massive scale other than just the situation, because now we're looking at it like, oh, if it can happen to him and it happens between him and another big producer named Cash Money AP, what's stopping it from happening to me? So that's what people start thinking if we push that narrative. And that's why I said this is not based on a story. It's based on a perception. And whenever you bring something to the public court, you know, it doesn't even matter if it's right or wrong. It's public perception will become the judge. I asked you guys, how long ago have you seen Lysol wipes? You said none. You said I have. You said yes. Yeah, we're not answering sample folder questions right now. I respect you guys, but this is not the time to be asking me how to do dubstep in 808 slides. My bad. I just used your dubstep. I wasn't coming at you, Jane. This is just not the time. Okay. But yeah, we barely saw Lysol wipes. So imagine what happens if that happens with loops that we actually use in the industry. Imagine if all the loops just stop coming and the transactions stop happening. That means less collabs. That means less influence, less leverage. That's what a recession is. It's when the banks don't loan. You can't leverage anymore. I know I'm speaking a lot of high level stuff. I'm trying to open you guys up to the bigger ramifications of if we keep stimulating this division. And this is only an incidence of this of division. It says, again, Wylo talks stolen sample on Pop Smoke album. So that insinuates something. It accuses somebody of something indirectly, of course. And again, I know it wasn't their intention, but I'm just saying that these little tiny things, when broadcasted, become bigger things. And we don't want to create a recession within the producer community, because we've spent the last 4 years building ourselves up. If you guys remember, I don't know who was here for 4 years ago, but the producer community was very competitive. It was very cutthroat. It was very secretive. I don't know if you guys were here back then. I'm not sure if you guys are here, but it was very different than what it is today. Nowadays, we're trading loops, we're crediting ourselves, we're building companies together, doing joint ventures, we're doing partner distribution deals, all this type of stuff. So it's completely changed. And again, if we keep bringing up these narratives of people getting screwed over, it's just going to cause fear in people. And then it's going to cause a greater division, which is going to take us back and recess us back, take us back. And that's why I have such a powerful stance with this, because I can understand both sides. But let's keep... Yes, I saw the survey. I'll get to your question. The survey, the new survey, if you're a new customer, didn't go out yet. I'll create a system to where it automatically goes out, but we're switching what's called autoresponders. I don't want to sidewind this live stream, because it's really not about anything that I produced or anything that... any 808 slides. I just want to keep it on point, okay, so people can rewatch it. So... You know, sharing more of my experience, that's what it comes down to with the what's called supply chain. Okay, so hopefully you guys understand that. If you don't understand that, you might want to rewind this live stream a couple times. But again, the easiest way you can understand it is think about how much Lysol you've seen in the last 2 months. Probably none. Now imagine if all the suppliers stopped giving you Lysol. Or imagine if all the loop makers stopped giving you loops. Now you're crap out of luck. Now there's less transactions, less collabs, less leverage. It's similar to a bank that won't loan out any money. Now you're on your own. You got to figure out how to make money on your own. You got to figure out how to get $500,000 for a house. The bank's not going to loan you on any of that money. So that's what a recession's called. Roomy Beats. Oh, shout out to, he's at work. Shout out to you. So hopefully I'm opening up your mind as to what the actual problem is. It's not necessarily Wylo versus Cash Money AP. It's the fear that's being put into people to not transact with each other, because we're a community. We're a pretty small community. If you look at the numbers on the producer community, I think we reached, you know, somewhere greater than 20 million producers around the world. It could be a lot greater now. I haven't done the new market mass, but we're somewhere around 20 million. Now, if you take 20 million into 7 billion, let's divide 20 million by 7 billion, which is the world's population. So 20 million into 7 billion. Let me say divided by equals 0.002. So let's multiply this by 100 so we can see what percentage of the world we are. We are 0.3% of the world's population. 0.3. That's less than 1% of the world is producers. Now, less than 1% is the rich people versus the poor people. So there's more rich people versus poor people than there is producers to the world's population. 0.3%. Excuse me. So we are a very small collective, and that's why we can't keep tearing each other down, because it doesn't make any sense. We need to tear these walls of competition down, because I'm going to get into competition and what happens when producers sign other producers. I'm going to get into that in a second. So if you didn't hear the whole story, you can go to Dylan's live stream to rewatch that. I'm not going to perpetuate any stories because I don't know the one side and I don't know the other side. But apparently somebody's loop was replayed. Apparently, according to this story, that's their story. I'm not backing it. I don't know the facts. I don't know the details. I don't even know what happened. But according to that story, that's what happened. Somebody's loop got replayed and put out as a song without their permission. Apparently, that's what happened. Okay. And so here's what we're going to get into. So producer credits. So this is, we'll be quick about producer credits. Again, we're getting more credits than ever before. This is because we all joined together in the last 4 years and have such a huge force and a voice now that we're not being manipulated by the industry. So that's great. We get more credits and great. Now, what's the benefit of a credit? Why should you get producer credits? So I'm not sure if you can look up, let's say, who produced. No, let's say, what's a song you guys like that came out recently, like a modern song? Okay, so let's just say Roddy Ricch for now. Credits. So when people look up Roddy Ricch credits, not only do they get a Wikipedia page, they get a nice little backlog. So let's say they come to the Wikipedia page, and what happens is, this is the power of credits that you guys don't really understand. It's not only for the music industry, it's also for the brands that contact people. So for example, brands know that, okay, if they want anything to do with the box or any kind of sound with it, they want to deal with the people involved with the song, the box. And they know that Roddy Ricch or Roderick Moore is probably busy. You know, he's probably extremely expensive. So they're like, okay, we probably can't get a commercial with Roddy Ricch himself because that'll cost $1 million. So let's figure out somebody in his immediate circle or his team that we can get to kind of have that same influence. So they'll say, okay, who's Samuel Glode? Or who's Adarius Maragne? Or who's Akil Tate? They'll look up those type of people because they know they were a foot plant in this greater act called The Box. So even brands reach out when you get credits. It's deeper than just, hey, I want producers who made this song that sounds like this. Because that's why we're thinking small. You're thinking small because you think that music business is only within selling records. The music business is in retail. It's in movies. It's everywhere you go to shop in the entire world plays music because they need the customer to have what's called an experience. And they play your music in the, you know, if you go into, what's that store called? Not Xfinity. I'm thinking of the Comcast people. Express Women. Or if you go into, name some shops. I'm going blank real quick. Kanye West in the excuse me, choking on air. Sorry, Kanye West in the Blood. Let's look that song up. Is that his new song? Oh, Wash Us in the Blood. Okay, Wash Us in the Blood. And then we're gonna type in credits. The grocery store plays music. Okay. Reach out to the engineer. Yeah, that's only one. That's more so for the music side, but you're right. Reaching out to the engineer. Because again, when you understand the greater way of how people get in touch with people that they can't even reach, they have to touch people that are near those people. The way you do that is you look at a credits list. This is your first beginning point to know who is all involved and who to contact on every level. So this is why people are getting so offended when they don't even get credit on a record, because it leads to so many other opportunities. Lids, they play your music. They play music. Foot Locker, basketball games, sporting events, live events, DJs, parties. There's so much music in the world that you guys probably just haven't fathomed as to how like ubiquitous music is. And I'll keep it short, but what ASCAP does, for example, is they'll charge people a monthly fee, and you know, they'll have a system to where it can recognize which songs that company's playing. And what it does is it takes out of that fee, basically like a retainer that you give a law firm. It takes out of that fee and it pays it out to the artist. And that's how people get paid for their songs being played in live places like Macy's or like a Foot Locker or Spencer's Gifts. Okay, so there's so many. Now, how many millions and gajillions of stores are there around the world? It's insane to even think of how many stores are out there. Okay, so that's one revenue stream that people just don't understand. So Wash Us in the Blood, okay, credits here, Kanye West, a whole bunch of people, okay? So again, if people are going after that influential group like Ronnie J, let's say I'm a company that wants a Wash Us in the Blood commercial style. Then I go, okay, reaching Kanye is probably going to cost me $20 million to even talk to the guy. What about Ronnie J? Can we get him on the line for $1 million? That's what I mean. Like, there's deals being created out of the credits, and that's why credits are so important. And that's why we need to create a universal, basically a database only for us that we can control, so there's a neutral understanding and that we abide by our rules, because that's what's causing the problem is everybody's trying to do their own thing with their own rules, and it causes too many problems. So producer credits, that's why they're important, okay? Now, this whole thing about robbing loops, again, shout out to everybody in here. We're reading the live chat. I'm just making sure we're getting to the point. Oh, my screen was blocked the whole time? Oh, no, it's not. Thought my screen was blocked the whole time. Why does my camera look super big? Whatever. So shout out to Dylan again. This is not bashing Dylan. I'm just taking this conversation because it seems a little divisive. Whether it's indirectly or directly, it seems divisive. I know Wilo's sharing his story. I can feel his pain because I'll get into a story about people robbing your ideas. So let's preface this a little bit. You guys heard of Native Instruments before? All right. Now, have you heard about Music Theory in a Day? Have you heard about Music Theory in a Day from BusyWorksBeats.com, which came out years and years and years ago? All right. So I want you guys to check this image out, which was my cover art. Now, again, for the people who have heard the story, forgive me for being redundant. But I randomly made this in Photoshop because I found out what the distort tool was. I had no idea what I was doing, and I just randomly created this, all right, which is very unique and very random. I even have like a little grid shiny thing in the background that I did by accident. All this was by accident. Okay, and I'm prefacing this because I want to show you that it happens on every level, okay? Every level. And this is a product that we have. It's a course product, and it's copyrighted. Whenever you put something out into the public, it's automatically copyrighted. Now, I want you guys to look at Subject B, which is Native Instruments Complete. And I want you guys to look at the new artwork that they've decided to choose on and see, you know, where was influence from. Come on, y'all. Do I have to even continue the conversation? So what I want you guys to understand is that it happens on every single level. Now, did I lash out to Native Instruments about it and cause a big uproar? No. Am I going to note it? For sure. Because Native Instruments is a company that tried to compete with me years ago because they were trying to get views on their YouTube channel. And I remember they were doing a bunch of videos and whatever. The craziest part is this company, according to a very reliable source who's in the industry, got $52 million of funding. $52 million of funding. Okay, I want you guys to understand that. And they were advised to put that money into what's called content or videos and articles and blogs and all this type of stuff. Now, what they did with that $52 million, they gave it to the complete wrong hands, because now we saw what happened to the Native Instruments brand. They had to lay off 1/3 of their company. That's the same as when, you know, in the Bible, it talks about God had to get rid of 1/3 of the angels in heaven. That's a lot of people. That's 33% of people, or however big it was, that they had to lay off. And it mainly ties back to this conversation around the $52 million. How was that $52 million spent? Was it given to MG The Future? Was it given to Craftmaster Productions? Was it given to anybody that you guys respect? Av McCree, I'll go down the list. Av McCree, Sharp. Was it given to KBZ? Was it given to who else do you guys respect? Producer Grind. Was it given to who's the YouTuber? Mai. Anybody. Curtis King. Kyle Beats. I haven't heard that money being spread. If anything, they gave out free keyboards, but that's not. If you're funded $52 million and you have a budget, you need to pay people right so they can do a good job. That's my point. I don't want to go into a diatribe about it. But you guys understand that this happens on a much greater level than just music. And my design was so random. This is too duplicate to be, it's not random. This is random. This is not random. Okay. And mine came out before theirs. So that's my incidents of that happening on a personal level. And the reason I shared that story is because I want you to understand that I've gone through this. Now, I didn't lash out and go public and all this type of stuff, but it's happened before. Now, another way people tend to do business, and I want to kind of open your mind to the business side of things, okay? So here's what happens. According to Wylo and his story, I don't even want to make this about Wylo and Cash Money AP, but that's just what I'm speaking on because it's the spirit that I'm speaking to. What's up, J-Man? What happens is when a producer sees another producer, they want to work together because one producer thinks they can, you know, join forces and create a symbiotic relationship to then do greater things. And it seemed, now the way he positioned the story, and this is why I don't want to be angled to any story, because again, if Cash Money AP wants to hop on here and talk about it, I am willing to hop and talk about it because I've never talked to the guy yet. I've never met the guy. I've heard his name a lot, subscribed to his YouTube, but I've never talked to the guy. So again, this is not an attack to him, and this is not me fully supporting what Wylo does. It's just me talking to the facts of my reality. Okay. Again, this is not story-based. This is not pitting one producer against another. I don't think that's the right way to go. That's why I'm making this live stream. So I'll keep it my rant shorter. When people go to sign other producers, they usually want to build them up. But sometimes what record labels do is they, let's look up the term for it. I think they call it benching artists. What they'll do is they'll sign somebody. That's not the word, benching. That is definitely not the term. But what they'll do is they'll sign an artist who's a competitor because they want to hold the competitor down from competing. So what they'll do is they'll sign someone to hold them back from competing. And then they'll take a percentage of what they're earning. Now, I've heard from high-level producers when I'm in these studio sessions. Again, I've dealt with people who have 10 billion-plus streams with a B, billion, five people in one room. Some of the biggest hip-hop producers in the world. It was Go Grizz was in the room. It was Bricks in the room. It was Nas Moore, who's under Murder Beats. It was Diego Ave. It was Swish, who produced for Post Malone, YG, and all those type of folks. Massively influential producers, okay? And in this group, I know that when you're dealing with other people, you typically collab with them because you are competing with them. So think about it this way. I'm trying to think of an easier way to explain this. If you know that you can operate at 100%, what's a better way to explain this? I'm really trying to think of an analogy. Let me just tell you straightforward what it is. Okay. They're like, okay, instead of competing for placements, let's collab for placements. Instead of competing to get clientele, let's collab. What that means is, okay, if I collab with, let's say, Mai, who's on the screen right here, not only do we have my network of people I can pitch the record to, I have Mai's network of people I can pitch the record to. So instead of competing, trying to take Mai's customers from Mai, and Mai trying to take my customers from me, we say, okay, let's just naturally talk to our customers individually, but then shop the same record that we both created. So now it's not me trying to take Mai's customers, it's just me taking a percentage of that transaction. And that's what's happening in the greater scheme of music production on these higher levels. They're not trying to compete directly for placements. They're saying, let's collab. That's why you see like 10 producers on a record. Let's look up the Illmind record with Drake. Shout out to Illmind, who's streaming a lot now. So shout out to Illmind. What is that record called? Somebody help me. Is it Blue something? Blueface. Man, what's that record called with Drake? I might be thinking of the J. Cole record. Let me just type in. Credit. I guess, yeah, it is kind of like if you can't beat him, join him. Now, that would be on the side of people signing to a producer. They're like, okay, if I can't beat this producer collective, I'm just going to join with them. Like, if I can't get in the eyes of some artist that Internet Money's producing with, I'm just going to join Internet Money because I can't talk to them regularly. That would be the if I can't beat them, join them. What is that Drake record? Blue Rain? Blue Tint. There we go. Thank you. Let's look up how many producers are on the Blue Tint record because you guys need to understand this. And you need to understand why there's so many people on this record. Hold up. Where's the credits? I don't even know how to look up credits outside of the streaming platforms. If you guys know a way, let me hold up. I have a point to make. And it's a really important point, because if you don't understand this, you're going to hold yourself back. But it's why we call, that's what we talk about is leverage. Blue tent. All right. So I don't know. Okay. We might be able to look it up here. Okay. Blue tent. Oh, it's not clickable. Okay. Well, at least, okay, here we go. So here are the artists. Okay. You have all these writers on it. And then you have 1, 2, 3, 4. Wait, is that JR Hitmaker? Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4 producers on the record. Now I've seen records that had 10 producers, something crazy, like 5 to 10 producers on it. Let's scroll through and see. Now it looks like it's max about 4 producers max on Drake's album alone. But the reason there's so many people is because they're saying, instead of competing for the same audience share, let's collaborate. That's why you see so many people on the same record, because what you're doing is sharing a bit of each person's audience, whether that's an artist who's going to buy the beat, whether that's a label executive who's going to pass the record, whether it's an end consumer. The point is they're using leverage, basically using each other's clout to get more opportunity. That's why you see so many producers on one record. It's not really that they're not skilled enough to do it on their own. It's because the value is not in the production skill. It's in the distribution skill, and it's in the network. Okay. So what happens when people take loops? Now let's get back to the whole point here, which is robbing loops. All right. So shout out to everybody in here. Av McCree, I would love to hear your angle on this later or whenever you go live. Another person to subscribe from, I talked about the Native Instruments $52 million deal and how they flopped and tried to compete against Busy Works Beats and actually failed, which is crazy to think that they were backed with $52 million and still couldn't beat the producer community. It's because we are sincerely about serving you, period. We're not about trying to figure out how to take a gazillion dollars out of your pocket and then upcharge you with an update the next year and all this crappy stuff that people just do just to get money. We're in the culture. We're of the culture. Okay. But let's get into the concept of robbing loops, because I mentioned the whole seeing 4 producers on a record, because again, they don't see each other as competition anymore. They see each other as collaborators for the reason of, instead of, I don't want to word it that way. You said, if you can't beat them, join them, because that's not really the case here. But instead of trying to fight for that one opportunity, they go, okay, I'll give up a percentage of the record. You know, that's your artist that you know intimately. I'll give up a percentage of the record just to be on it, instead of fighting you to get their attention. So that's what's happening. And with, what am I trying to get to? I'm really trying to get to another point about robbing loops, but I'm trying to say it in a softer way, because I don't want to come across as if I'm persuading anybody to think a certain way. So full disclaimer here, what I say next is not accusing anybody of anything. I just want to be fair in sharing the business side of what happens here. Okay. So with all said and done, producers are collabing more than fighting and competing. So what happens is labels, this is just a label mentality, they'll sign a producer so that they don't compete. And that's basically the same thing as collaborating with somebody so that they don't compete against you. Okay. And the difference is, and when we talk about signing producers, the difference is that labels will purposely have this intent to hold you back. Some labels. Okay. So this is such a bigger game that you guys might not understand. That's why I'm trying to like tippy toe around what I'm saying. What happens is on a business level with labels, they'll sign, let's say 2,000 acts, okay? Out of those 2,000, 10 are going to be their main money makers. Those 10 carry the rest of the 2,000. So basically, once they find their money makers, the other 2,000 are just in the way of the 10. So they'll figure out a way to control the 2,000 by signing them and then telling them, no, you can't release this record now. No, you can't go to this venue now. No, you cannot be a part of this festival. And they can push them out of the way of the people who are actually getting the money and who they want to push. That's what record labels do when they sign you, to get you out of the way. Now, I know before we talk about signing producers and producers signing producers, I don't want to put negative stories in your head, because there's benefits to that as well. But let's just leave a side note that people do sign competing acts, okay, to hold them down. And I'll get into what that means. But let's talk about robbing loops. Okay, so hold down. Now, in this scenario, there was a team involved. So it wasn't just one person directly trying to do something against another person. I think it was a team thing. So sometimes you don't, this is why I said I'm not trying to even make it about Y-Lo and Cash Money AP. I'm just going to make generic statements. If you guys want the Y-Lo story, go to Producer Grind's Y-Lo Talk stolen sample on Pop Smoke album, ? Again, kind of indirectly accusing Cash Money AP that it was stolen. That's, that, you know, whatever. But shout out to Dylan. Shout out to Producer Grind. I'm wearing his merch. So, I mean, he has a lot of influence. But anyway, let's talk about robbing loops and what happens. So again, if you go back in the live stream, I talked about a supply chain. And the reason I gave you so much preface and context is to understand the competitive nature of producers from the beginning. You got to remember, these are people who live by the placements that they get. So of course they're going to be cutthroat because they need to survive. They have to be cutthroat. And what happens is, you know, I'm going to tell you a couple stories and I'm trying to be vague enough so that it doesn't implement anything. So what happens is, okay, I'll give you a scenario instead of like telling you a horror story. So let's say producer A comes to producer X, and producer A is on a record. They collab with producer X in the studio. They spent money on the studio session time and all this type of stuff. Everything was cool. And then they didn't do any paperwork or any kind of talk about what's going to happen with the record while they were making it. So then producer A recalls that in the session that all producer X did was type in the hi-hats. So they want to, when they talk with their lawyers to get it cleared to, you know, whoever the pop and hip-hop artist is, they go, forget producer X. All he did was add the hi-hats. I'll redo the hi-hats. Forget him. He barely touched the beat. But in reality, they were going into the scenario thinking that whatever we do, regardless of effort, is going to be split up. That's why I said early in the live stream, I said words in the air are not there. If it's not on a piece of paper and you're not both signing it and it's not a legal document, it doesn't exist. It does not exist. Words in the air are not there. So that's why I said don't be fooled by people telling you about all the stuff they're going to do for you if it's not written down. Don't sign if it's not written down. The clear benefits of what you get. So again, producer A and producer X collab. Okay, 3 months later, producer A gets a placement through his network. And let's say Kanye West wants the record. Then producer A remembers that all producer X did on this beat was add a stupid simple hi-hat. He's like, forget that person. I'm going to redo the hi-hat with a little change. And I'm gonna have all the credit so that I can get the fair share of what I deserve. So producer A is like, forget producer X because he didn't put in effort. But again, this is not a conversation of effort. It's a conversation of what you agreed on going in, regardless of effort. This is a conversation of network. This is a conversation of distribution, of opportunity cost. It's not a conversation of how hard did you try to make the beat sound good. Because again, if that were the case, there are producers who sign musicians and have musicians come in as work for hires. The work for hires do all the work. I've seen this on an extremely high level. You know, I don't want to expose people's sessions, but the world's great multi-Grammy winning songwriter, I was in a session with them and I remember that, you know, at a certain point in the song, he had musicians come in and he had these other people come in, which basically made the whole beat. And he just sat back and was like, you know, did his thing. That doesn't mean he's less valuable. It just means he was guiding the ship and it means that he was the songwriter who led the ship to go a certain way. He just told the musician what to play. Just because he didn't have the skill playing the keys doesn't mean that he shouldn't be credited on that record. Same thing here. Producer X should have just as much influence over the record's percentage as producer A because they are both part of the intentionality of the record. So hopefully I'm making sense here, but the point is producer A will go back and be like, okay, all he did was hi-hats. I'll redo the hi-hats, change them up, do whatever to make it sound different. And we're going to cut producer X out of the deal. And this is what I think caused the scenario within the producer community. And it's a real thing and it has happened before. You know, even if it's not hi-hats, it might be the drums or it might be like a little lead line or something. They might change it up a little bit. Or let's say they'll have a loop from another producer and, you know, the loop, they won't like, because again, here's the missing key that I just realized. A lot of you guys don't deal with negotiations back and forth with lawyers. That's why you don't understand half of this. Because again, if producer A goes into a session with producer X, and they agree to create a song together without any paperwork, And then what happens is they go to release the song. It gets placed and all this type of stuff. Now it's time for the paperwork. And then what happens is producer A will go and want to share credit with producer X. And here's your percentage. Here's my percentage. You get 20, you get 5%. I get 20% and blah, 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 blah. Then producer X is like, yo, we said 50-50. Why am I getting 5% now when we said we were going to split it? And now there's a battle of percentage and royalty points and all that. Now there's a negotiation battle between this lawyer and that lawyer, that law firm, this law firm. And basically what it comes down to is the person, it's the words in the air are not there, okay? Once you understand that concept, you'll understand how to create less confusion when you're working with people. So again, the guy who created the hi-hat in this scenario is asking for 20% of the record when all he did was the hi-hat. But again, it doesn't matter how much he did in the beat. The agreement was, if we're working together, we're working together, we're going to split it. So stop talking. Most of us understand what it's saying. So you want me to end the live stream? What would you do in this case, Honor Rebel? You lead the pack and we'll see how far it goes. What I'm telling you is a real story, and I'm trying to code it as another allegory, because if you don't understand this, you'll be in the situation where you're fighting with your lawyer to get 5 extra percentage points when you should have gotten your just due. And they say, okay, instead of going back and forth with negotiations and with lawyers, they're going to completely cut the guy out because he's giving them a headache. You don't want to be the headache guy. That's my point. You don't want to be that guy that makes you go back and forth with lawyers, because it costs you money. Lawyers cost money. So if he has a counter offer, you have another offer, that back and forth costs hourly time. So now not only are you wasting his time, you're upping his retainer fees and doing all a bunch of stuff. So now it's not even worth him to give you that percentage, because you just ate up that percentage trying to negotiate with your lawyers. So as he says, F that guy, I'm going to cut him out the deal. I'm just going to redo his hi-hats. That's the reality of what happens. And that's why I can see stuff like this happening if people don't understand it. Now that's one angle. So we're going to talk about another angle to it, which is, according to this story, somebody was like, I'm not going to give names, but somebody said they were offered to sign to a producer. And he said he didn't sign to the producer because it was good benefits and everything. But he said he didn't sign. And after he didn't sign, magically his loop got remade and, whatever. And this caused the scenario here. So there's a deeper context to that. And a lot of people missed it because they don't understand the business side. The problem here is not just the remaking of the loop. And that's where 99% of people are getting thrown off. That's why I said this title kind of insinuates and accuses Cash Money AP, Wylo Talk's stolen sample on Pop Smoke album. Gotta be careful with that, how we use conflict in the community, because I think it's just going to spawn a greater division. That's what, if you rewind the live stream, I talked heavily about, we don't want more division. We've already spent years trying to bring each other together. So because other people covered it, I didn't see the other stories. All I saw was the producer grind story. So another way, and again, this goes to the context of record labels signing their competitors. So think about this way. Let's say, and again, I don't want to use names because I'm trying to take this off of personalities. But let's say producer A wants to sign producer X. Same scenario. Producer A wants to sign producer X, and he wants them to have a production deal together so that they can collab versus competing. Okay? Collab versus competing. That's another key point. So the first key point was words in the air, not there. And I want you to think collab versus competing. Now, here is another angle to it with the producer A and producer X thing. So producer A is going, wow, man, that's my competitor. Let that sink in for a second. Producer A is now going, that's my competitor. He is eating up market share. I want him out of the way. Now that producer's thinking like a label. He's going, okay, I already have my profit centers, they're called. I already have my money makers, my golden cows. You're just in the way. So what they do is they'll come to you. Hey, here's a dope offer. You know, here's some good benefits. We're going to sign you, put you here, here, and here. We just need you to sign here, and then we can get the rocking. So it looks like a great deal. It may have great benefits, but the intentionality is to sign that person to then bench them and hold them back, to push them out of the way from you getting to the place that you want to go. So when you have that lens to it, you will understand why, excuse me, you can understand why producer A in this case would sign producer X for their talents. And then all of a sudden, if producer X doesn't sign to producer A, now producer A recreates what producer X did. I'm just saying hypothetically, I'm not even putting this on anybody's name. I want to be very clear about that. So then we have producer A recreating what they wanted from producer X. The reason that would happen is because they saw producer X as a competitor to begin with. And the point of signing producer X to producer A was to get them out of the way. So in response of producer X not signing to producer A, they go, producer A thinks, okay, you're a competitor now. If you don't want to collab, you're a competitor now. You're a full-on competitor. What they do at that point is recreate the competitor's products. That's what made Amazon massive. That's what makes all these companies hate when, like, for example, Snapchat and Facebook. That's a perfect example. Snapchat had the world's best story system. Facebook said, hey, you're a competitor. We can either buy your company, basically sign you. We can buy your company if you're not going to sell your company, which is a mafia move. They go, if you're not going to sell, which is like you have to sell or else, once you give it that context, it makes more sense. Sell or else. Now, if you're not going to sell, we're going to completely rip your stories idea and put it into Facebook and Instagram. That's what's happening. It's called business acquisition. It's not a pretty game. It is as cool as it sounds to sign to somebody and sign to a record label. Sometimes it's because you're being acquired, and being acquired is a war. It's not a good thing sometimes, unless you built your business to be acquired. Then that's a different conversation. Again, I'm trying to tell you guys the bigger game to this so that you can stay out of these type of situations. So let's talk about producer signing producers. What kind of benefits could you get? I'll be quick about this because every producer is different, and for the most part. Yep, WhatsApp. They bought WhatsApp. They wanted more market share. I'm sure they came to them with a deal, like sell or else. And that's, again, if you guys understood business, you would understand how deep it goes. I'll give you another business example. This is a little bit beyond a lot of people's scope, I understand. So forgive me if I'm talking like Chinese to you guys. But for example, some modern TikTok is almost about to be banned in America. I don't know if you guys know, but TikTok, the platform that gives you super amount of streams and all these cool things and get your brand out there and blah, 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 billions and billions of streams, mostly fake, is being questioned with the security within the USA and could potentially be banned. So if this whole platform is about to go down, let me bring it back to positivity, because it's not a negative. What I'm saying is not negative. So I have to show you the positivity in this. Let's bring it back to signing producers, because I don't want to be negative, but just understand TikTok could potentially be banned right now because of that very fact. If you're a competitor and you don't sell, what happens? You get bought out. So let me give you a high level business example. So for example, let's say some lumber mill, okay? Some lumber mill conglomerate who has a bunch of lumber mills around the area. Let's just say, I'm trying to think of an easier. Yeah, let's say a lumber mill, because this would be a company that would use debt, okay? So they have a factory. Each factory is worth $10 million a factory, okay? Now, a company wants to come buy $100 million worth of the factory. So let's say they want to buy 10 factories, $10 million apiece. But the lumber mill guy, the guy who owns the lumber mill, or the board or the company who owns the lumber mill, won't sell because it's been a family business for the past 70 years. And they won't sell because they want the cash flow, it's called. What these people can do when they're using acquisition models is they'll use the banks as weapons in this case. They'll go to the bank and say, okay, we'll get $100 million line of credit and we'll go buy the debt of the lumber mill. You guys probably haven't heard of that before, but you can actually buy someone's debt, which means you can control the asset without them even putting up any fight. Okay, so let's say the lumber mills they cost $10 million apiece. And the person who built the lumber mill did not spend $10 million to get it up and running. They spent $1 million. That means they're in debt $9 million to the bank. Okay, so what I can do as a person who's trying to acquire your business is go to the bank who loans you the $9 million at, let's say, 10% interest. Okay, I can say, okay, I go to bank B and I get $10 million at 4% interest. And then I can go to bank A, in this case, and give them the $10 million to buy, which means they instantly get 10% on their money, is what I'm trying to say. They instantly get the 10% that they want, which is the $10 million there. So I give them the $10 million, and now I control your asset for 4% instead of 10% interest. And that's what happens on a business level behind the scenes, like with Facebook and WhatsApp and all these other companies. You, even if a company doesn't want to sell, they can be bought. And that's why I said, when people come to the approach of sell or else, that or else could mean buying out your debt. That or else could mean copying your products. That or else could mean diluting your products or making it so that it makes it a commodity. So that's what I mean by it's like a mafia mentality type of approach. And it's called acquisition model. Get down or lay down. That's a better way to put it. Get down or lay down. That's exactly the philosophy some people have. So that's why I said you don't want to always think, oh, he's trying to sign him, he's the good guy or whatever. I'm not trying to put that on anybody's name. But just because somebody wants to sign you does not mean they're out to do good for you. And it doesn't mean they're out to do bad for you either. So let's talk about some positivity. What benefits do you get from signing to a producer? So here are some actual tangible benefits that you want to look for if you're signing to a producer. It's more than money, okay? And sometimes, like a label buying other labels' debt, yep. Sure, labels do it too because they have so many assets. I think the movie industry and the music industry are the greatest asset holders in the entire world, meaning there's millions and millions and millions of songs. There aren't gazillions and millions of homes. Well, technically there are homes, but there aren't gazillions and gazillions and gazillions of like malls in the world. Whereas music, there's tons and tons of assets to control. So it's one of the top markets that have the most assets. All right. So, yep. So what do you guys think? I'll let you guys kind of chime in here. As Dylan would say, don't forget how many producers stole artists, singer with percentage, Neptunes. Yeah, I don't know all the little nuances of it. That's why I said I don't want to make this a him versus a him thing, because it's so much bigger than that. It's a mentality thing. But I want to ask you guys, what kind of benefits would you want if you signed to a producer? What would you be looking for? What would you expect from another producer? I'll write my list, and then we're going to compare it against your list and see how much in common we have. All right. And I'm going to use some basic words so that I don't sound like I'm speaking, you know, a different language here. Tips for sound selection. Do you think that's a benefit? Or you're asking me? Well, this live stream is not about music production right now. It's not about the how-to right now. We're talking about stuff that's going on in the culture. So what do you guys think? More exposure. So let's talk about that. More exposure to what? To an audience? Or do you mean to the people that you're selling the beats to? Who's the exposure to? Thanks, Donnie. Appreciate that. We can dig into Splice. I'm going to show y'all something that just will change your whole mind about Splice. Time dedication. You want that from signing to another producer. You want that other person to give you time for what? Time to do what? You want knowledge. Okay, that makes sense. I like that. You said networking. Okay. Building relationships. Okay, I can see that happening. Tap into their friend group, I guess. All the music over the past 40 years. Freedom to create, work outside of the collab. Freedom to create, all right. Credit, signing just to get your name on a record, I like that. But we shouldn't have to do that, right? We should have that automatically. Networking, more exposure. All right, I would never sign to anyone way not built by your own, be your own empire. But if you can't run an empire, sometimes you got to link up with people who have a greater empire than you. Plug beats. Okay, so we have some good expectations. More placements. Okay, that's a good one. So let's go through this list real quick. So exposure, my question would be exposure to who or to what? If you're talking about getting your song in front of, you know, a greater audience of listeners, I can understand that. But then how would you take that and then flip it into your own thing? I'm assuming you mean building your own brand. The next benefit you guys said was artist relationships, meaning how do you talk to artists who don't want to talk to you by you being yourself? In that case, accelerating the connection between you and getting a placement or working with the artist that you want to work with. Now, would you have to sign for that? That's up to you. I don't think that's always the greatest move, but if you're looking to just build a credit list to make you look cool, basically, that could be a reason why. Time dedication was kind of vague. I'm not sure what you meant by that. Knowledge, I can definitely see you signing somebody for knowledge. The same thing goes for internships. You're not working for free. You're actually getting a massive amount of knowledge that you can't get anywhere else. And that's why I think internships are amazing. Networking, you can do this on your own. You're basically saying to sign to somebody else. You're basically saying to make friends, you have to sign to somebody else. Now, in that case, it's you not wanting to put in the work. But sometimes if they promise guaranteed things to come out and guaranteed like a pool of people that they're going to work with, then it's worth jumping into their networks because they have a set amount of people who are going to make the songs and going to distribute the songs no matter what. And they have a lot of leverage, it's called. A lot of people don't have leverage. They just know a lot of artists. That doesn't mean they have leverage to say, okay, put it out now, because the artist could be under somebody else's control. So the real question is, yes, this person can know a lot of people, but do they have pull like that? Like, for example, you could say, oh, I know a lot of street people, but if you're not a Jay Prince who actually has the pulse on the streets, or I'm just saying Jay Prince in this case because he's known in hip hop culture, if you don't have that kind of influence to actually, you say something and it's done, it doesn't matter how many street people you know, because they're going to hear you talk and they'll be like, okay, they're not going to listen to you. So that's the difference when you're talking about their private network of people. Do they have relationships that actually listen to them and are actually going to put those moves into motion? The freedom to create, okay, that's a good benefit you want. You want producer credits, all right? So that makes sense again, but you should want that from default. That shouldn't really be something you should sign to somebody else for just to get credit. But maybe you meant to get your credits up, like get your catalog up. Maybe that's what you meant. And I can understand that. It's much easier to leverage somebody else's. Like, okay, if I'm going to buy a business, I'm going to buy a business that already is making $100,000 a month. I'm not going to buy a business that's struggling off the ground trying to figure out how to make money. I'm going to buy the business that already is making money. Same thing goes with if you're going to join somebody who has all the relationships already. Of course, I'm not going to join with somebody who barely knows how to make friends with somebody in the industry. Same thing there. You said plug beats. Yeah, you definitely want I don't want to talk so businessy. But in this case, you're signing for what's called distribution. You're signing to allow someone else to distribute or use their network to sell your beats. So you're basically buying distribution at that point. You're giving up a percentage of your potential earnings to somebody else so that they can distribute it. The same way Febreze gives up maybe 30% of their revenue to Walmart because they want Walmart to distribute and sell Febreze. It's just a necessary cut that you have to give if you want to expect so many people on the other side to buy your thing. And then lastly, you said placements, same concept as before. Placement, if a person, here's the distinct that you have to really understand. A person could have a bunch of credits, have worked with Drake, have Young Thug credits, have Travis Scott credits. If they don't actually have a relationship with Travis Scott, Drake, or Young Thug, the chances of them actually even having contact alone could be low. And a lot of people think that, okay, I'm signing to a producer who worked with Drake. That doesn't mean they have any pull with Drake or any pull with Young Thug. So you could be signing off of an illusion. And that's the key that I want to get into. Before you sign to those type of deals, when people flex how many people they've worked for, not worked with, but worked for, you want to be really careful and really ask them how much influence they have over that relationship. Can they get in contact with these people? Do their ideas even come out, or are they always under the artist's thumb as to what's allowed to come out? Because if they don't have pull, there's no point. And I don't care how many credits you have. If you can't call up that artist and put out a record on your saying, then you don't have any relationship that you can control. It's based off of just knowing somebody, just to know them. That's not really control. That's more you just knowing somebody. I know a lot of cool people in the world. That doesn't mean I can get them to do what I want. So just make that distinction before you start signing to people who have a bunch of credits, because credits don't mean a darn thing as far as influence. Let's read Av's comment. He says, I don't know why people always search for collaborations with people well above their pay grade. Is it that difficult to understand? Once you establish yourself, people will come to you. I guess it is. I'm trying to get to your point with people well above. I don't know why people always search for collaborations. I see what you mean. Well, what they're trying to do, in my opinion, is gain self-value through validation. They want to be validated. They want someone of higher status to then say that they're valuable. And that puts status upon that person to now feel more valued and feel like they're valued in the community because, I got the stamp from Drake. Now I'm more valuable. Because they don't have their own self-esteem. That's what it comes down to. And they're always seeking that validation. So those are the benefits you want to look for if you're signing to a producer. And again, this is all ties back to the YLO Cash Money AP thing. I'm not putting names to these stories. I'm giving my perspective, what you need to know. And just, I can't have the division keep happening in the producer community. We were doing good, moving forward. And now we're having stuff that's bringing us backwards because we're supporting conflicts that should be positioned in a different way, in my opinion. Again, my whole goal is to prevent what's called a recession within the producer community, meaning that the suppliers, we don't want the suppliers to hold back to the merchants, because then there's no transaction, then there's no business, then there's no leverage, then there's no nothing. That's a bad move, in my opinion. We don't want that to happen. So again, you can go back if you want more details about what I just said, but that's why we created the producer community. Now, this is an entire new concept, and you guys have probably wondered, you know, we sent in loops 4 months ago. What happened to the loops? What happened to sending in loops busy? It's because I wanted to make sure that everybody was protected. So if you guys remember, we had a community loop folder, and we had crazy people in there. Noria was in there. We had SM Beats. We had, who else was in there? That was fire. We had Noria in there, SM Beats. I could actually pull it up. What am I trying to guess for? Actually, I'm not sure if I have it on this computer. I might have to re-download it. Let me see if I have it here. Here it is. Okay, so we had Loops in here. We had Aaron Barber in there who contributed some crazy, crazy. Now, these are the people who I had to double curate. So in the beginning, I forgot to send people out a, hey, you agree that these are all royalty-free loops in an email type of thing. So I had to get like a verbal agreement that it's all royalty-free. I had to get it in writing because, again, words in the air are not there. So I got all these people to agree in writing that they are giving them out royalty-free without expectations of a bunch of stuff. All I was asking the community was to do was give them the credit so that they can get more brand deals and more opportunities that way. So now the benefit for the people contributing to the loop folder was that they get to now instantly collaborate with over 500,000 at the time. Now it's 700,000 producers around the world. They get to instantly collaborate with 700,000 producers around the world. That ups your odds of collaboration and actual stuff happening by an exponential amount. So that's what they get out of this. And they have their contact information and everything to contact them if you want to give them credit or ask for more private work or whatever it may be. Or maybe you just want to collab with them. That's the whole point of the producer community folder. And then you guys get the benefit of having loops instantly at your fingertips. For example, we pulled up a loop from SM Beats that was just, it just had the right mood because I was producing an R&B record. And I couldn't come up with a good melody on the piano. And I said, I'm sitting here with the artist, Sinead Monique at the time, and I'm trying to come up with this melody. I couldn't come up with a good melody, R&B melody. And I was like, freak, I keep scratching my head trying to make a melody. So I said, let's just run through some loops so that I can get a vibe and we can build around that vibe. Because I've seen that happen in top studio sessions. They don't sit there playing the piano until they figure it out. That eats up time and it eats up the momentum. So I went through a bunch of loops. Oh yeah, we'll get into the splice thing in a little bit. So anyway, I went through the folder of loops and then we found this cool guitar loop from SM Beats. And then we started off with that, instantly came up with a vocal melody and the track was amazing. So that's what we get as users of the loops. We get to instantly come up with these vibes and instantly come up with song ideas. And the people who contribute the loops get instant access to hundreds of thousands of people who are going to collaborate with their loops. They get to offer them basically, for example, 7 Foot G, the guy who made those guitar loops for you. He's getting people following him on Instagram, hitting him up for private, whatever. He's getting people thanking him. That you get to build your brand through this. And now you say, okay, the dopest loops are from this Bufo folder. He has the dopest loops. So now Bufo has instantly created a brand. So it's a win-win-win for everybody. And my main goal right now is we're working on the paperwork. And we have the paperwork done. I'm just working on one more thing, which is an end user agreement, just so everybody's protected. I'm going to protect the people who send in the loops meaning the people who are contributing to the Loop folder, we're protecting you so that you get your just due credit. And we're protecting the people who use the loops, because the biggest issue with royalty, what people call royalty-free loops, is that, okay, they go to make a record, record blows up, and now the person who made the loop's coming after you. And we don't want that to happen. So we're protecting both the user and we're protecting the contributor so that everybody's going to play fair. And we're creating what's called the producer community, so that you can have free access to all these loops, and then these guys could help build their brand, and we all get to do massive things on a massive level. It's going to be much more than just loops, but for now, that's what it is. So that's what I'm building behind the scenes. We already had lawyers and law firms look over all the documents to make sure everything's pristine and clean, and that's what I've been doing behind the scenes. So I'm working on it for you, and that's what it is. So let's talk about Splice real quick, and I'll wrap it up here. The reason why we want to have our own producer-owned community is because we want to lift each other up. We want to make sure that we all succeed and help each other out. Whereas companies like Splice, and I have a couple friends who work within Splice, so by me even making this comment, I'm kind of like potentially angering somebody who works at Splice. But whatever, I'd rather stand for the truth than watch the producer community just give away all their value. Okay, so for example, Splice, royalty-free sounds and rent-to-own plugins. Now, I've had a Splice subscription. I actually had a recent scenario where I logged into Splice because I'm on a new computer now. I'm on a Mac. And I went on Splice and I went to download my sounds because they're all on my PC. So I went to re-download my sounds and it said I couldn't download the sounds. And I emailed the support team and I said, hey, I can't download my sounds. Like, what's wrong with the app or whatever? They said, you have to have your subscription back active. So let me get this right. I spent $30 a month for however many months, let's say 2 months, and then I downloaded all my sounds legally, okay? $30 a month or whatever it was. Because, and I'm gonna get into every point about why Splice is tearing down the producer community. But again, before I do that, I'm gonna honor the people who are on Splice, because this is not for me to bash them. It's a bashing to the greater structure of what Splice represents and what it's turning into. So how do you go to the charts on here? Let's figure that out first. Can you get on the charts without, anybody know how to get on the charts on here? They used to have a chart. I don't know how to get to the chart. Maybe they took off the charts. Or maybe you have to log in to see the chart. Let's go to community. Let's explore. Let's look around a little bit. Community, explore. No, we want sounds. Browse the catalog. Here we go. All right. So when people come to Splice, they're thinking, okay, I'm going to get sounds from the dopest producers in the game. They look at the top charts. And again, I'm going to first start with adulation and honor Kashmir. He's in our private producer mastermind. He is number two on Splice right now. Shout out to Kashmir. Who else is up on here that we rock with? I'm just going to shout out every producer I rock with. I don't know Super Mario, but shout out to him. Any producer that we actually know, shout out to them, because they're just trying to do a deal with Splice and run. They're not trying to like build up the antithesis of what we represent, but indirectly they are. Okay, who else is up on here? It's Kashmir. I know Decap was on the Splice charts for a long time. Did I say Decap? Yeah, Cap Sun, who's the creative director over at Splice, I think, is on here. Southside has his drums on here. I think Scott Storch had drums on here. So shout out to everybody we know who are actually of the community. Okay. But what I think is they're using these people's influence to build up their greater brand. What if Boy Wonder never put his drums on Splice? Would it really be Splice? What if Sunny Digital never put his drums on Splice? What if Southside never did? What if Kashmir never did? What if Decap never did? Would Splice really be Splice? What if Murder Beats never put his drums on Splice? Let's be honest. Would Splice really be Splice? Because you look at all these other kits and you look right over them. I don't look at any kit that doesn't have like a producer that I respect's name on it. And I'm being honest with y'all. And here's something that I had to do recently was they made me resubscribe to download the sounds that I already bought before. I already bought the sounds and they made me resubscribe to download the sounds that I already bought. That's number one against Splice, is that you don't even have access to the stuff you already downloaded. So what do you really get to download if you can't even download it again? So two about Splice is this. a guy, this is a point that you're not going to understand unless you get a Splice account. So let's look at their pricing real quick. And this is the reason why we need to create our own producer community. The same thing as Splice, basically, but owned by producers. It's because they're just trying to milk the community. We're actually of the community. So if you look at their pricing, let's see. Let me see their price chart. I'm sure they have a price chart somewhere. Let me type in Splice pricing. Let's see, review of Splice. That's not from Splice, so we don't want to go to that website. Splice worth it, da da da. But I know they have different plans. You have like a plan where you can have, I think it's $7.99. You guys in the chat could probably do a better job at the pricing than me because I haven't been on here in a while. There's a $7.99 one. There's a, let's actually make a fake account, I guess. Sign up. All right, let's make a test account. We're not going to call this fake. Let's call it test. It's called test, test. My name is test. My email is test@testing.com. And my password is test, test, test. A username or email already exists. Okay, let's say test@222. All right, well, let's say my email is test2@testing.com. Maybe they have a filter that prevents you from doing it, which they probably do. But their pricing is like $7.99, $10.99 or something like that, and $29.99. And you get different credits based on whichever plan you want. The problem is when you go to the charts and look at the top packs, the packs that you want start at 300, which there's limits to like how many sounds you can get per month. So I forget the tiers of it. But basically, if you want to download this Cashmere, the whole pack of Cashmere, you would have to spend like a grip to get those 3,950 sounds. If you wanted the thick drums kit, you would have to use almost all your credits to get it. So when you get Splice, you think that you're going to have access to all these kits and different things, but really you can only download one full kit at a time. Or you could just download the kick from here, the snare from here. Unless you want to spend that much time going through each individual sound, good luck. But that's the other problem with Splice, is that you think you're going to have access to so much stuff. And then when you get there, you realize that every kit has like a gazillion sounds in it. So now you're spending your entire monthly budget on one kit. So you're not getting as much as you would expect. Another reason Splice is a hindrance to producers is because if you open up your drum, and it's making you a commodity. So each sound, from what I understand, is one credit. Okay, so let's see. Download, starting at $7.99, cancel at any time. So that's the membership I'm talking about. But if you wanted to download it, it will cost you one credit. Okay, so everything is one credit. It doesn't matter if you spent 3 hours on a loop or 1 second on a snare drum, it costs you one credit. What they're doing is saying that every sound is equal to each other, which makes you a commodity. It makes you a complete commodity, and it lowers the value of whatever you're contributing on Splice to the point where everything becomes the same price. So the crappy kit that somebody puts out is the same as the most bomb kit that's out there. And that, you know, it's kind of like, not communism, but what's the word I'm looking for? Like, if we're talking about a producer union, there's something called collective bargaining. So the problem with collective bargaining is that you can have people working extremely hard, but they're only paid the same as somebody who's not working that hard. Okay, and that's the problem. You're not compensating effort. You're not compensating talent. You're not compensating value. Everything is the same. That's another reason Splice is terrible. Like, why are you building up these companies that are destroying the community? I just don't understand it. And lastly, the reason why Splice should be looked at, I should say, and that we need to create our own Splice, which is what I'm basically creating for you in the producer community, which is our loop folder. And we're going to make it look fancy and stuff over time. But another reason is you can have a free Splice account. So what's stopping me? What happens is people sign up and they can cancel and get their money back, I believe. Okay, so what's stopping people from downloading your sounds and canceling and getting a refund? Nothing. Your sounds are not protected on Splice. So what Splice is doing is making it seem like there's a safe, which it is a good business model. But the point is, it's built not for you, but to commoditize you. And what they're doing is leveraging the cool people that they put on the platform and attracting more people because they think, oh, these cool people are here, so let me be on the platform. And now they're destroying all your value. And now they can make you into a basically a factory, a machine that can replace you at any time with the next guy that wants to come on the platform. And you're creating your own destruction with Splice, in my opinion, the way they do business. Okay, now I'm sure they do deals and stuff, but again, all these points are the reason why Splice is killing the community, in my opinion. The fifth reason, Splice, and again, I went over the free account, so it's not really protecting your sounds. Somebody could sign up for free, download the sounds they want, and be out. Not a protection advice, or not a protection device at all. So get that out of your head. Now, the last point I'll make against Splice here is, I'm trying to think what I was going to say about Splice. I'm thinking of the usability. My brain went blank for a second. I should have just went off on my tangent while I had it in my brain. Because once I forget my thought, I forget my thought. But what do you guys think about Splice? Like, do you really support Splice? What do you guys think? Let me pick your brain for a second so my brain can get to whatever point I missed. $7.99 for 100 sounds, $13.99 for 300. So I'm glad you brought that up. Let's go back to the top kits or wherever we were a second ago. So, okay, $7.99 for 100 sounds. So if you want the Murder Beats kit, for example, and you only pay $7.99 a month, Murder Beats, where's Murder Beats? Okay, he has 65 sounds. Well, let's go to the Thick Drums, okay? Let's say you want the Thick Drums kit, you want the number one kit on Splice. You only have 100 credits. You can only download a third of the kit. What's the point of a subscription where you can't even download the entire kit? What's up, the artist? Nafi's here, what's up? So it's $13.99 for 300 credits. Even if I had $13.99 a month, I still can't even download the top kit. I need 44 more credits to do it. So you're basically spending the same amount of money you would just buying from the vendor themselves. So why go through a Splice? What does Splice do for you? It's just a marketplace, and they're leveraging the fact that we see all these big names on their platform. That's why they do deals with these people to put their stuff on the platform so that they can attract more people to put it on it for free. And my advice to you is stop putting your stuff on here for free, period. If they're not paying you for your advertising and your name, what are you putting your stuff on Splice for? All you're doing is devaluing your own brand and the greater producer community by commoditizing your sounds and making everything sound the same. Not only that, here's another point about Splice. They literally have recycled sounds over and over and over and over and over again. And by recycled sounds, I'm not talking about that one kit might sound like another kit. I'm talking about sounds that people just grip off of whatever kit go on Splice, but they get away with it because it's Splice. And nobody questions, oh, this is really just the Timbaland snare, or this is really just the Polo de Don snare. This is really the Young Chop snare. But they get to put it under the guise of this corporation. It's the same recycled sounds. So what are we building up this corporation for if they're not giving back to you? That's my question to you. And I think I'll leave off on that point. I want you to really think about why we're supporting this corporation who hasn't given any of you jobs, given any of you opportunities, hasn't given any of you any leverage to make business moves. So why are you building up your enemy? Okay, so anyway, just keep in mind, the producer community will be here soon enough. We just have to wait on some end user agreements, drafts, and then get the website up and running. And then you'll have access to royalty-free loops made by the community for the community. And again, the people who contribute get to instantly collaborate with hundreds of thousands of producers around the world. They get to build their brands instantly. You get to benefit because now you're using sounds that you know you can just go through for a vibe. Pop it in your beat, do whatever you want to do, make your beat. And just all you got to do is just give the folks credit. It's a win-win situation. We are already here. We already have the talent. We already have our own numbers. It's like, why aren't we working together at this point? And that's the whole goal of the producer community. And hopefully you can see the reasons why I don't rock with Splice. I will never put anything on Splice. It's tearing down a community. I don't see why you guys do it. Is a term for them? Everyone talking loops, kits, and making their own anyway is a term. Oh, Spice. No, Splice. S-P-L-I-C-E. I wonder how much Murder Timbo I'm making off Splice. I can see if people just don't have a brand already and they're trying to leverage an already buying audience and do it that way. But if you're not using this as like an advertising platform to get your kit advertised more and you're doing it as sole, your only form of income, then you're working backwards because you're giving your power away to some other corporation that doesn't really care. Since you can't get the full pack, then it doesn't make any point. What's the reason for subscribing if you don't get the full pack? Then where do I get the full pack? It's what I'm saying. There's so many fallacies and conundrums as to why people even use Splice. I don't understand it. I can understand the affordability aspect, but at the same time, you're spending the same amount of money. Why give it away to this corporation that doesn't care? From my stance. And they could say, oh, we care. We hold events. We do this, this, and this. We care. No, if you cared, you wouldn't commoditize everybody's sounds. If you cared, you wouldn't have to make people buy in again to get access to what they already downloaded, especially if it's a sound. Now, if it's training materials and video materials, I can understand because it's like going to college. You can't just go to college and then go back and be like, oh, let me sit in on another lecture, professor, because I forgot what you said 4 years ago. That's different. If we're talking about sounds, something that you already bought, it's like buying a hat. Like I wore a hat, now I have to go back to the store, buy it again to wear the hat that I already bought to wear. Again, commoditizing is the biggest thing you guys have to be aware of as to what this platform is doing. And then lastly, it's not guarding your sounds at all. People can sign up for free, download your sounds, and be out. Get their money right back. And vendor, why'd I put vendor here? Oh, recycled sounds, and I forget what I put vendor for. I'm not sure what that note was for. All right, so I'm going to get off this live stream, but I probably will be live streaming a lot more today because I feel better now and I have a lot to talk about. So let's wrap this up. But again, Dylan from Producer Grind is not an attack on you. I just didn't want to offer an angled conversation to what was happening. I don't want to add an angle to it. I just wanted to be extremely neutral and talk about the business side and the benefits and the dissonance of it all. So again, let's unite as producers and stop tearing each other down. I don't think it's going to help anything. It's just reversing our progression here. I'm Game from BusyWorksBeats.com.